Doesn't take much.
Please rise and pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence for the sick, the handicapped, the departed, and the military personnel of this community. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mike Fulmer.
Here.
Bruce Valducci.
Here.
Bill Henderson, Boston, Bill Owens.
Here.
Jeff Colosimo.
Here.
Deborah Ducci.
Here.
Bart Cherry.
Here.
Pat DeBlasio.
Here.
Tom McDermott.
Here.
Joe Sykes.
Here.
Randy Collins.
Here.
Chad King.
Here.
Bill Chilio.
Here.
Dennis Malta.
Before we get to the visitors list, normally we get we start sweating when we see this many people at a meeting. But we're going to turn this over to our police chief and fire chief. Don't they look nice?
As usual. Thank you, Council President. The reason why Chief Chilio and I are here tonight are to commend the actions of two of our officers for an incident that took place on December 6th, which was a Tuesday, at 2:30 in the afternoon in the borough of Bridgeville. Basically on that evening, Assistant Fire Chief Ray Costain was working on his house and he observed smoke, a plummet of smoke coming over the area of Ramsey and Patterson Avenue. He left his house to see what was going on. And he observed a car over the hillside, which was at the dead end portion of Ramsey Avenue. The car was also on fire at that time. Assistant Fire Chief Costain notified County 911, who dispatched police, fire department, and medics. At that time, Patrolman Matthew Haley responded to the scene, and he arrived with Assistant Fire Chief Ray Costain. They observed a car over the hillside wedged against a tree, which quite possibly kept the car from flipping over and landing on the railroad tracks adjacent to the old Holy Child School. The car was visibly on fire, and the interior of the car was filled with smoke to the point where they couldn't tell if anyone was inside the vehicle. Officer Haley and Assistant Chief Costain approached the vehicle. Officer Haley broke the driver's side front window and found an elderly female behind the wheel. He pulled her from the vehicle, and with the help of Assistant Chief Costain, took her to the top of the hill and safely out of harm's way. Within seconds of this happening, the car exploded multiple times, became fully engulfed, and was a total loss. Fire chief and the rest of the fire department responded, put the fire out, and fortunately nobody else was in that vehicle. So we're here tonight to formally commend these officers for their actions that night. Chief Chilio?
Ray, come on up here. For you, the Bridgeville Borough Life Saving Award. In grateful recognition of your heroic efforts that resulted in the saving of a life on December 6, 2016 on Ramsey Avenue, to Ray Costain, firefighter of Bridgeville Borough, presented by the Fire Department in Allegheny County Commonwealth.
Yeah, don't forget us.
Sorry. This time I'd like to call Officer Matthew Haley. Matthew, in grateful recognition of your heroic efforts that resulted in the saving of a life on December 6, 2016 on Ramsey Avenue, we present you with this plaque. Also, I have a formal pin to be worn on your uniform for meritorious conduct for your actions on that afternoon.
Congratulations. Yay, Matt.
Why?
The end result of this issue was that the driver of the car was a 78-year-old female. She had suffered a seizure while she was driving, which led to the event taking place. We believe she became confused at that time. Instead of turning on Bower Hill Road from Washington to go to her destination, which was Mount Lebanon High School, she ended up at the dead end portion of Ramsey driving over the hill. As she was being pulled from the vehicle, they also believe she suffered a heart attack. She did suffer a heart attack. They believe that happened was the vehicle exploded from the mass hysteria that was going on. She is alive and well, currently living out of state with family members at this time. I believe the mayor has a few words also that you would like to add.
Just very briefly, on behalf of our entire community, thank you both for a job well done. And thank the departments that you represent.
Thank you, appreciate it.
One thing I do want to talk about very briefly is we also try to make money, and yes, we do pay the gambling fee to the county, and these are for two Penguin hockey, two people, to the Penguins versus the Panthers on Sunday, March 19th. So see me if you want to buy one, your $5 each. Money maker, helps pay the bills. One thing I want to bring up tonight, and I already talked to a couple people about this. Please, those of you who can, put pressure on PennDOT. If they're going to build apartment buildings right across the line on Godwin property, and if they're going to build all these homes and apartments out off Navy Road, then Upper St. Clair, South Fayette, and PennDOT ought to be putting another two-story, I don't care what kind, to get the traffic over that way. They can get on 519, they can get on 79, and they will be able to get on that new highway if it ever finishes, 43 or whatever number. So I'm asking, please, to help people get out of their own streets in Bridgeville, please put pressure on PennDOT. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Bob Fryer.
Hi, excuse me, thank you. I came across some sketches and reports about Bridgeville and the advantages the communities had for a long time and the advantages that it still has and we should take advantage of. This is, as you've seen many times, those dark lines of 4 to 5 four-lane roads that are pouring traffic and have been doing so for 40 or so years onto two-lane wide Washington Pike through Bridgeville and Soffit, which is the cause of our problem. The other thing I want to mention to you is, because Bridgeville was here, I guess, 150 years before the other communities in the area.
Yes, oh, that's true.
Thank you, Greg. It has to be, all of the roads lead to Bridgeville. And within the 3 or 4 block area of Bridgeville, the 3 or 4 major regional roads come into this junction, and PennDOT has not done much at all to try to widen those roads, improve the intersections, and so on. The other thing I wanted to mention to you is, these things are all obvious to you, but I want to give you the overall view that you might not have thought of. This is I-79, and this dotted line here is Washington Pike. I-79 was specified by the Federal Highway Engineers to run parallel to Washington Pike from Washington, PA to Canadian, and it was so close in some places it went over the top of Washington Pike, as we all know. The reason for that was the pike was supposed to be the unrestricted access road to the only north-south interstate road in western Pennsylvania. By the way, this area here through Scott Collier Township and the area up here in Cannonsburg and part of Cecil, there was, as a result of the traffic congestion problem being resolved, the economic development was enormous. As we all know, there's something like 6 shopping centers, dozens of new office buildings, hundreds, probably that's 1,000s of jobs, and new businesses. And some of our people took those positions. The other thing I want to mention to you is, during the period of time that this is I-79, and this is Route 19 through Upper St. Paramount, Lebanon, and Norman. As you know, in I think the late 1960s, when I-79 was built, 75% of the transient consumer motorists that essentially created the financial foundation for Upper St. Clair, Mount Lebanon, and Dormont moved to I-79 through Soffit, Bridgeville, and Collier.
Well, and just interrupt. What's the point that you have?
This is something
with all the
new information.
What's the point of your showing all of this?
Well, I want to get to the point about the section of road between the post office and the 7-lane bridge. And I want to make sure that the left turn stacking lane is there. But just let me show you 3 more of these, and I'll get to the main question.
Bob, you realize that the drawing that you gave us to reline the road between the post office
and the bridge,
and the bridge is yeah. What's in there right now.
Well, that's what I wanted to. Well, let me get to the point.
No, I'm just saying, you want to address that. You brought us a drawing that we actually submitted to the task force, and that's what's in there now.
Okay, well, something Lori mentioned at the last meeting or the meeting before sort of made me question that, if I can go through that. You're right, I provided the drawing to PennDOT and talked to someone down there and told them how important it was for that left turn to be in front of the church to go up to Chartier Street. And I think a couple, I heard from one of those people, and then I think that the next meeting, Lori mentioned that the left turn stacking lane for Chartier Street is going to be in there. However, the last meeting I was at, I don't think it was the last one, Lori, it was the one before that, I heard that the curb alongside, the curb across the street from the church in front of the drugstore wasn't going to be moved. And I think it's impossible to have a left turn, a left turn stacking lane without moving that curb over 12 feet and tapering it to zero at the end of the street. That's this last one.
If the Chartier Street curb is being moved, Bob.
Is the Washington Avenue?
No.
The Chartier Street curb is being moved
to gain a left turn lane.
That's exactly right.
Okay, that's correct.
That's an additional stacking lane for cars coming down here going left and right.
And what's going to happen is when the bridge is widened, the bridge widening will be enough to pick up that right turn onto Chartier Street there.
This one right there.
Exactly. The one thing that they've got a challenge with right now is they're dealing with the Army Corps of Engineers relative to having, even though they're widening the bridge, they have to go to the Army Corps of Engineers and get their approval to widen the bridge. Mm-hmm. So there is no negative impact on the flow of Chartier Creek relative to the Fulton Flood Control Project.
Well, that's no real problem.
It is.
Why?
It's a major problem. It all sounds simple, Bob, that we have the bridge widening. But what it's doing is if they do any changes to that bridge, they have to run a hydrology study on the waterway to make sure they're not decreasing the cross-sectional area of the bridge.
Yeah.
There may be an outside chance that the bridge has to be completely replaced.
Which would
involve the possibility of the elevation of the bridge going up. What PennDOT is trying to do, and with their consultant, is trying to figure out how can we gain width without having to replace the entire bridge. And that may involve them using a shallower structural design member for the bridge.
Underneath.
Right, okay. So, that's the biggest challenge. Once they get past the Army Corps of Engineers, they can proceed with their design. Now, they do have a designer on board who was selected back in December to do all the work. They have all of the drawings. Mike Haberman has been in communication with McCormick and Taylor, who's doing the design work, and has shared all the information, has had an informal meeting with them to kick things off. So they're well aware of what the concept plan is relative to the Route 50 task force.
Well, that's good, but the point I'm trying to make here, and I agree with everything that you said, I think 2 years ago, Mike and myself and Bill Calusi talked to a representative from the Department of Environmental Protection that came down to Bridgeville to measure the bridges on the block from my bed. So we sort of got a mini course in the hydraulics and number of cubic feet of water that flows per second. But the point, I want to make sure that we aren't led into a false sense of security in this respect. That bridge has to be 7 lanes wide, not 6. Because if it's 6 lanes wide, it's going to happen eventually. Excuse me. Since most of the traffic coming off, let's say, from 79 and using the 7th lane going east on Chartier Street, most of those people were from Upper St. Clair and Bethel Park, all right? So of course some of us use it too. But what I'm concerned about, unless that's a 7-lane bridge, they can, somewhere down the road, they can just say, you know, Bridgeville doesn't really need 2 lanes of consumer motorists going into its community. They should be happy with just one. We're going to take this 7th lane and make it an exclusive right-hand turn. That's what I'm concerned about. And like, I just want to make sure that you guys get some sort of, if this is the plan that they're going to use, make sure you get something in writing to make sure that down the road they don't do that. Because the attention of all of these road improvements, as you know, they like the Churchill Street widening, and they like doing things over toward the interchange. That's all for east-west movement. I'm concerned about, and you're concerned about, north-south movement between the Southhead Business District and the Bridgeville Business District. We have to have two lanes leaving from here, going over there, unobstructed, so Bridgeville isn't left with 40 more years of traffic congestion. And we need two through lanes coming from Southhead into the Bridgeville Business District for the same reason, to sustain the financial stability and the potential of this business district. The point I'm trying to get at is, I don't know how they're going to put a left turn stacking lane in here for Chartier Street without moving this curb and sidewalk just 12 feet. I mean, the condition of the sidewalk, by the way, I'll give you photographs. The condition of the curb and sidewalk, as I'm sure Lori is aware, is bad. There are cracks in the sidewalk, cracks in the curbing. The number of people that walk down that curb to the new food store down there, they're primarily
Is there a final comment you want to make?
Yeah, I want to know that you guys will address these issues and get assurances from PennDOT and an explanation on how they expect to put a 10-foot wide left turn stacking lane there without moving that east curb 10 feet.
Yeah, thank you, Bob.
You're welcome. You have a great opportunity.
We already saw the tree, Bob.
Right. That's a once in a lifetime opportunity.
Minutes. Motion to Borough Council regarding the minutes of January 9th, 2017, public hearing as submitted.
So moved.
Yes. All those in favor, Bruce Gallarducci and Bert Cherry, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to the Borough Council regarding the minutes of the January 9th, 2017 regular meeting as submitted.
So moved.
Bruce Gallarducci?
Second.
And Bossman, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to the Borough Council regarding the minutes of the February 1st, 2017 workshop meeting as submitted.
So moved.
Joe Barucci. Joe Clausen.
Comment on it.
Okay.
Comment. I have a comment.
Oh, you have a comment?
Okay. Yeah, it was neat to see everything that we talked about that night in writing.
Oh, okay.
I think if we can start on a lot of that stuff that I agree. Miles ahead, I think it was a real night of work.
All right, Board of Work, Board Appointments. Oh, we didn't vote on the last one? Oh, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries.
Oh, yeah, check mark.
Board Appointments. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the reappointment of Laura Deckerwall to a 5-year term on the Parking Authority to the first Monday in January 2022. Mrs. Deckerwall has submitted a letter of interest to continue to serve. Motion.
So moved.
Bruce Gallarducci.
I'll second.
And Joe Barucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the reappointment of Richard Deckerwall to a 4-year term on the Planning Commission to the first Monday of January 2021. Mr. Deckerwall has submitted a letter of interest to continue to serve.
So moved.
Second.
Bruce Gallarducci and Joe Klossmer, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion of the Borough Council regarding appointment to a 5-year term to on the Zoning Hearing Board to the first Monday of January 2022. We have a position up on zoning. I'm going to make a motion for Eric Schmidt.
Second.
Make a motion for Jeff Gallarducci.
Jeff Gallarducci, is there a second?
Second.
All right, we get the vote on.
You're doing is like motions, not nominations.
Right?
hearing, so if you do it like a motion, you need to let the one die or have,
so
it'll become academic.
Gotcha. All right. So Eric went first. I guess we have a roll call vote, obviously.
Alderman Fulmer?
Yes.
Bruce Galaducci?
Yes.
Neil Lyons?
Yes.
Joe Quasimo?
No.
Joe Verducci?
No.
Bert Cherry?
No.
Thank you.
What's that? Also, the amendment of.
We need the second.
The minutes were not that did not pass.
Not did not pass.
Three.
No, it's three.
Three.
Right.
That's your type rate.
No, I don't know.
But I think it's three. Okay.
Why is it that?
I don't believe one appointment from council five words.
It's a motion of council. It's a tie.
I don't believe it's off.
Well, what's the time? It's 3-3. Three voted yes and three voted no.
I'm going to get a cup of coffee.
He got at least a man.
We table this until he gets us a.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
Okay.
Throw this one.
I make a motion to table till
confirmation.
If I could note for the record,
yes.
So that Mr. McDermott, that my vote would be yes. Okay.
Gotcha. All right. Captain, conditional use application, 929 McLaughlin Run Road. Conditional use application has been submitted by Ronald and Sharon Captain for the property located on 929 McLaughlin Run Road. The property is located in a mixed use district. The applicant proposes to conduct light manufacturing and electrical products specifically designed for the railroad industry at this site. Light manufacturing is subject to 903.23 of the zoning ordinance. The applicant has met all requirements as set forth in the ordinance for the Planning Commission and Engineer Sites, recommending consideration for the application by council. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second. Bruce Galaducci and Bert Cherry, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries.
Well,
the bridge wall.
Thank you very much.
See, I thought all them people were here for you.
Can we have a quick, what you do?
Sure.
Sure, wherever you're comfortable.
I'm comfortable right here.
Do you have any gizmos?
You know what? We're going to bring them as a we thought would be necessary. But I can certainly describe it. Our product line is mainly for lightning protections for the railroads. We also build power supplies for the railroads, little circuit boards. And we have them here for the planning committee meeting. We passed them on there. You guys were looking at them. We also make little tiny battery system protectors for the railroad. If you're driving down the road, you see railroad tracks, and you see these little silver houses, little buildings, different sizes. Well, our stuff goes in there to help protect the electronic signaling system and keep the train running. That's what we do. We have some of the major Class 1 railroads. Actually, one of them, Union Pacific, has standardized on several of our components now.
which is a real big deal for us.
Absolutely.
It's huge, big deal. So, and these guys have not only investigated on their own, they've had our stuff installed since 2007 in the highest lighting areas in the country. And in those many years, they've had zero equipment failures where they have this stuff.
That's great.
And you know, we were complimented by them for that, because they said just the first time in history on these lines that we've had no lighting failures.
Okay.
So, and that's, I mean, we're real proud of it.
Absolutely.
And we have a couple of products that are out there. In fact, Union Pacific is standardizing on these. We've got thousands of these parts, these components, and in all these years, at zero failures. And people, in fact, at the railway show, which is every year, this year it's in Indianapolis in September, and we go to these shows, and we have people come to our booth and talk to us about this, and one of the questions is, what is your failure rate on these parts? What percent? And I said, I can't answer that because it's zero. There's no percentage. And we had one guy say, don't believe me. And I said, why don't you believe me? You asked me the question, I answered it honestly. And they said, we don't believe you. And I says, well, okay, would you feel better if I said we had a 10 or 15% failure rate? Would you buy the stuff then? I just walked away from our group. We didn't know what to do. We've never had that confrontation before where somebody said, hey, okay, this is what you're telling
me. Nice problem to have.
Yeah,
it is, because we now have Amtrak looking at our products seriously. In fact, they've bought a bunch of it already. In fact, I was supposed to have a teleconference meeting with them this week. And we're in competition with a huge company. We're very, very small. So you probably won't even know that we're there at 929 Block Road. At least not for a while, but we're growing. And we plan on continuing to grow. And we're going to get, if we get another one or two more railroads, we're going to be really hot. And we're going to be, we already have a reputation out there. Okay, now it's a matter of the groups within the railroads arguing amongst themselves. Like some of the older fellows, they want to have like the big names that were in the industry for a century. And now we're coming along here. We're 18 years old, our company. We are full-time in this company for the past 5 years. So we're, and people look at us like, well, you know, these companies have been around 100 years, and this guy's been around 80 years, and you're here for, you know, 4 or 5 years, and so yeah, well, we've got to start somewhere. And the proof is in the pudding, guys. Buy our stuff. We have a 2-year warranty on everything we sell. And we're thinking about making a 5 to 10 year on a couple of parts. And the reason is we've had no failures in 10 years, 15 years. Some of the stuff is 18 years old. Our very first products. So, and that's one of the ones that Union Pacific has standardized on. And what it does is it goes on to the main breaker panel in these houses where the AC power comes in. One of the highest hits for lightning strikes. The power lines go for miles. And what happens is these power lines get energized, come down the line, and they'll do one of two things. They'll either blow apart the protection that's there, or it will go past the protection, get right into the equipment, and destroy it. Even with the protection there. And a lot of the protection that's out there, they have no idea that it's made. I was on a site for the Wisconsin Central many years ago, which is now being purchased by Canadian National. We were in a bungalow, one of these silver bungalows, and I says to, they had a lightning protection device up on the main breaker panel, and I said to the guy, I says, do you know if that thing's working? And the guy says, I have no idea. I said, well, you have one of your maintainers take it off the panel, let's crack it open right here, take a look at it. We did a screwdriver, we have this thing, epoxy, with the lid shut on it. Took a hammer and a screwdriver, popped it off. The thing was pure charcoal, burned to a crisp inside. The chief engineer of the railroad looked at it and he says, I wonder how many of these we got out here like this. And I says, it's not doing any good. And he goes, well, how is yours better? Way more energy you can handle. And we advertise protection, you can see. It has a clear lid. You can look right at the parts, you'll know right away if the parts are burned. Right away, maintainer walks in the building, he sees the little lights on, it's like, okay, we've got power, we're good, the box is right. If you lose one half of the 240, the 120-240, which is your house power, if you lose even half of it, the light goes out. It says, hey, we got a problem here, one of our phases is out. Okay, the other thing is, if any of the parts that go bad in this, the way they go bad, the way they fail, they'll produce smoke, which covers the clear lid on the box. So this thing is sitting right on top of the breaker panel, or on the side, underneath, if you can put it in which direction, no different positioning that's better than any other. It's good everywhere. And they can see the light inside, says, okay, we've got power, it's in the right phase, we've got it all good, and oh, this is all black here. Okay, well, what do you do about that? Jeez, I've got to call an electrician to change it, just like all of our competition's devices. No, you don't. Once that thing is in, it has a removable front cover, captive screws. They don't fall and get kicked out the door under a rack or something like that. It's there, right here for you. Maintainer will never lose it. And then all the wiring is fully insulated, so they can actually disconnect this box if they want to replace the whole thing without getting shocked. But we do tell them to put breakers in series, turn them off. But if they couldn't, for some reason, trains are coming or whatever, you can do it all right there on the panel, and you don't require an electrician to come out and change it out of the breaker panel. Any maintainer can do it. And the parts, there are three main parts, the actual surge protection parts. They're like a giant version of what you would buy to protect your computer. Okay? Instead of go around discs that are 20 millimeters, these are 53 millimeters. They can handle 70,000 amperes of current from the lightning strike. Yeah, that's more than even the NEC and UL and all those recommend. So when that happens, let's just say one of them decides to burn out. Well, one of the questions from the railroad was, we haven't had this happen, so we don't know. And we do know because I'm the designer. Okay, I analyze all this stuff and do the calculations. And they said, well, if that happens, we're left unprotected until somebody goes in and repairs it. I said, well, you're not really unprotected because we have two stages of protection in there. You lose the one, you've got the other, and you're still up and running. Well, I tell you, when they heard that, it was like, whoa, okay, this is good. And we can see it. We know if it's bad. Okay, what's it take to repair it? Let me take that cover off. The devices, I should have brought one of those with me. The devices that are in there, we have to take in, we put a bend in the legs of these huge MOVs, and we cut a U-slot, actually we don't cut it, the manufacturer does that, we have cutting it in quarter turn on the screws, slide it out, slide the new one in, quarter turn, spit inside the clear cover, take a paper towel, maybe, I don't know, railroad, you'd be surprised how resourceful these guys can be, okay? I've been to many, many locations over the last 45 years, they'll just wipe that out, put it right back on, they're in business.
Another great brother. Yeah. I can see the fascination. Man.
Yeah.
Hey, well, it's compassionate about his job.
And he's in his hand. I've been doing this a while.
I can't tell. Welcome to the bridge.
Welcome.
I think this location at 929, I think it's going to work for us. I really do. We're going to grow. It's going to be, at first, there's going to be Sharon and I, and then one other individual. And then two, and then three, and then four, you know. So, good. I know. I'm tying up your time. Thanks for listening. If you have any questions, just give me a call. I'm glad to talk with you.
Thank you. I just want to invite you to an 1871
Walmart. There you go. There's the Hulk.
There's the
1921. Thank you. Well, that's the other nice thing about Bridgeville. It's a lot of railroad history here. So that was one of the things that we really liked about
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thank you all.
All right. Thank you.
Back up again.
Yeah. Hey, just to regroup, I apologize. Yeah, a little confused. We're going like a hybrid of a nomination and a motion. Your motion was first. You were correct. Not one of the exceptions. So where you were, which you made a comment for me, you can't remember.
Which he did.
That's a good reflection.
Thank you. Eric Schmidt is on Saturday. Resolution number 2017-01, motion of Borough Council regarding resolution number 2017-01, resolution authorizing the execution of cable franchise agreement between the Borough of Bridgeville and Comcast Cable Communications Management LLC. Agreement was approved by council at the January 9th, 2017 regular meeting.
So moved.
Thanks. Bruce and Joe Colosimo, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Resolution number 2017-02, a motion of the Borough Council regarding resolution number 2017-02, resolution authorizing the Borough Manager to submit the application for traffic signal approval to PennDOT for the adaptive signal light to be installed at the Chartier Street / Washington Avenue intersection.
So moved.
All those, Burke Cherry and Joe Ricci, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Resolution number 2017-03, motion of the Borough Council regarding resolution number 2017-03, a resolution authorizing the disposal of records in compliance with the Municipal Records Manual approved on July 16, 1993, in accordance with Act 428 of 1968. The records have, well, records to be destroyed are listed in Appendix A, page 1, and have been attached to the resolution.
So moved.
Bruce second. And Joe Colosimo, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Draft design standards. Motion of the Borough Council authorizing the submittal of the draft design standards for review by the Allegheny County Department of Economic Development as recommended by the Planning Commission.
So moved.
Second.
Burke Cherry and Joe Colosimo, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Real quick.
And I just wanted to note, as we discussed before, they need to be kind of put into a submittable award form.
Yes, absolutely.
And we will do that prior to submission.
And I just want to make a comment real quick that we have three of our Planning Commission here who worked tirelessly on this, Nino, Dale, and Tim. These guys met over the last probably 2 months, I don't know how many, probably a dozen times, and really did a lot of work to come up with some draft designs, that, some standards that really can work. So I want to commend them.
Thank you.
Bill list. A motion of the Borough Council regarding the February 2017 bill list.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Oh,
Mr. President?
Yes.
No good deed should go without consequence. They did such a good job that I'm hoping and looking forward to a similar energy with regards to Baldwin Street and Bower Hill Road.
Right. Is there a motion on the bill list? The one with Joe? Joe Bricci and Bruce. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Payrolls. Motion of the Borough Council approving the payrolls of February 17, 24, March 3rd, and 10 of 2017.
So moved.
Joe Bricci?
Second.
And Bruce. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Monthly reports. Motion to accept and pay any commissions due January 2017 real estate tax collector report. Joe?
Second.
And Bert? All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Motion to accept December 2016 financial report.
Yeah, I'll do one more. I'll move.
All right, Joe Ricci?
Second.
And Bruce? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept January 2017 police report.
So moved.
Joe Colosimo and Bruce Gallardi. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. All those opposed? No, all those. Motion carries. Motion to accept the January 2017 zoning report.
So moved.
Joe Colosimo.
Second.
And Clark Cherry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion motion carries. Real estate tax refunds. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the following real estate tax refund due to a change in the assessment as requested by the real estate tax collector, year 2016, lot block 254-E-336. The amount is $263.03 to Kent Wang Zai Kwan and Nancy Zhu Yen.
So moved.
Burt?
Second.
And Joe Klosman. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Committee report. No report. Finance, Joe?
Well, after we had a very successful workshop a few weeks ago, now we have a little bit more direction, so I'd like to, in the next few weeks, schedule a finance committee meeting. So, okay. We'll be doing that soon.
All right. Parks and Rec?
No report.
Public Works, Bruce?
Yeah. I just want to thank our Public Works guys for the excellent job they did cleaning the roads and that over the last couple of weeks. I think are second to none at this point, is my feeling. So they're out there and they're doing their job, so I really appreciate what they do.
I was out Thursday night, I got in Pittsburgh, and it was a mess, like late, got to break it all, and it was clean.
Yeah.
So it's like,
welcome.
Yep. Seriously.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Public safety bill is not here. Mr. Mayor.
No report.
Good man.
I said listen more about his career.
Thank you, Council President. I'd just like to say that we quite possibly have solved one of the greatest mysteries of 2016. And tune into our Facebook page tomorrow, because I can't think of a better day other than Valentine's Day to announce what that was.
Oh, I can't wait. Wow, look at me.
You sound like the news reporter.
Just to keep you there for the whole hour.
Facebook.
What time? You better give me time.
Tomorrow morning, probably around 9 or so.
All right, perfect. Solicitor report.
Well, since the mayor did. I have my regular report. I don't have anything. I would add probably, if I could request just a brief executive session to go over the legal matters.
Absolutely.
Solicitor's report.
Okay. Engineer.
Thank you, Mr. President. A few things here. We've got the contract back for the plunger fairs, and the contracts are out for the CCTV work with AAA Pipeline. Once they've been sent back, the borough can execute them. The 2017 payment maintenance program, currently assembling a list of roads to be considered for 2017. We'll include some of the roads that Pennsylvania American Water Company to replace the main line. Hopefully we can do some shared costs on them to get those roads done. I'll be preparing an estimated cost for presentation to the Public Works Committee prior to the March Council meeting for consideration. McLaughlin Run Park Phase 2, the bidding documents have been sent off to DCNR for review and approval prior to the project being out for bid. Once we get them approved, it will get it out for bid. Nothing new to report on the Washington James development since our September 21st, but since you have the design standards, that'll help them move forward at some point in the future. Okay. And then last thing, the Chartier Street, Washington Avenue, and Chartier Street Bridge intersection. We had a project status meeting with PennDOT on January 26th, informing us that the design engineer had been selected in December, and that they would be kicking off with the designer. It's called McCormick Taylor. By the end of February, they're the design engineer for PennDOT who are doing improvements to I-79. So it kind of makes sense that they know the 79 corridor and they're working on that. So part of the other thing was the meeting was to make sure that there was a commitment of funding, pretty close to all the money being committed. There's representation there from Newberry. Through their efforts and channels of contact, have a big chunk of the cost to be committed towards the project on the order of about $3 million. So we're looking, I think, at about a $7.5 million, $6 million project. Yes, to February 2019 to 11 days.
What's
that mean? It'll be between now and February 2019. They'll be working on the design, and then they'll advertise for bid in February 2019 and take bids from the contractors. So this work will be, I know, unless we have a magic wand.
Okay.
That's all.
That's pretty far.
Yeah, it is.
Some Travis.
All
right. Okay. Thank you very much. Fire Chief Ochilio.
Thanks, Mr. President. You guys got our report for last month, and I just want to say thanks for all the support for us and you guys and everybody out there.
So you have the fire the other day?
Yes.
Are you having family all right?
Family's okay. The dogs passed away a couple days later that we saved. That's really sad thing. It's under investigation still.
Southbridge.
Evening. Made Dan go to work tonight. That's why he's not here. He's out doing what he's supposed to be doing tonight.
There you go.
The only thing I have to offer is our annual subscription drive. We'll hit the mailbox near you in the next 2 weeks or so. It's important for us. Is anybody that deals with anything going to the hospital, deductibles, co-pays, all that kind of stuff, is that as a resident, to your advantage to enter into that, we write off 50%. There's a lot of factors that go into it, but it's important to us to help us with our working capital. But just to let you know, it's coming to a mailbox near you. Our subscription drive runs from April 1st to the end of March, so we're right on time putting it out there. So.
Will you be assisting in the Carnegie area with the problems that they had?
No. Yes and no. If they call, we go in there. That's correct. But we have no direct relationship. Scott Township handles it primarily, and if they need mutual aid, then we go in at that point in time.
Okay.
All
right. Library.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. Updates from the Bristol Public Library. The Library Director, Cheryl Mapshick, submitted her resignation last month. We now have the interim director is Ben Hornfeck. He has served as our library manager in Bridgeville. And the new interim library manager in Bridgeville is Erin Weaver. She's been in our library. We welcome you to stop by and say hello. And the transition is going smoothly. The next announcement is we're having a night of dancing and music with the Mansfield Five, Doo-Wop Classics of the SMPJ Club on March 4th, and there will be food and beverages and fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Manager report, Lori.
I submitted my report.
More business?
Can you hear my former friend down here with the fence?
No, actually, in my report I noted that I haven't heard back from him, and I'm going to instruct Fred Zapp, our building inspector, to cite him.
So, yes, that's enough.
Yeah, I mean,
that's reasonable.
I told him in the email that council wanted it down, and he's not responded at all, so I'm going to have Fred cite him.
Thank you.
All right, old business, new business.
Bridgeville Athletic Association asked me to announce that the March 12th is their annual bingo fundraiser. It will be done at the fire hall.
At this time, we're going to go to executive session.
You don't take any action, you can just
adjourn.
Okay. I just need to know. All right. Well, it's just information on my part.
All right, what's that?
I make motion to adjourn.
Okay. Motion to adjourn?
Yeah,
I make motion. All in favor?
Yeah.